of communication like that. That's sort of why we're here on the Earth, is really to communicate. That's why
multi-sensory.
Right. That's why there's, instead of one of us, all of us.
Yes.
And we are all one and many.
See, now there's the Android meme. It imitates the ecstasy of communication technologically. You see how much it's like the basic nature of human beings, which is communication. So what separates humans from other parts of nature is that they create solidifications of the communication from writing and that. I mean, the birds communicate, but they don't write it down. They don't make a television show out of it.
Right.
That is what we do. That's what we leak out of us collectively. But then that creates a babble, a problem.
Well, it's a problem only, it's
if
not.
If you don't understand it.
Well, I don't think it's a problem. I think first nature, or you're calling the Earth itself, is desiring this level of communication to exist. So it's not a babbling as much as anything in nature is babbling.
Okay, but you're using words to communicate this.
Right.
On a medium that's electric.
Right.
Just think of all the other media that are activated now by people and the communication going on. A few words and a few definitions which we're haggling out here has no impact on the collective multilinguistic communication.
Okay.
That's the matrix we're in, even though we are being meaningful to each other.
Right. So what can people learn from the years of study? What can people do in their lives right now that will help them be happy?
Nothing. They can do nothing. Now start to live with that fact. Shut your babblings that define that you are going to do something. Begin to look around and perceive where you're inside of, what the nature of it is.
What you're inside of as far as your home?
Which is inside the satellite proscenium arch and the web and all these amazing automobiles in New York City. You know why New York City is not an American city?
Well,
America was built on the printing press and the newspaper and those visual bias means of communication. But New York is acoustic space, and you know what it makes? What makes it acoustic? The canyons of the stone buildings. The resonating effect turns New York City into an echo chamber, which brings out all kinds of tribal enthusiasm and individual eccentricities like old tribal societies celebrate and have. But the more Puritan, Victorian, traditional American archetype kind of society in the rest of North America is nowhere like the New York environment. So New York is molded by the acoustic space of what Le Corbusier said, hot jazz and stone. Now that's just one medium we're inside of.
Yeah. What also makes New York interesting is that it's a three-dimensional city. Most people live two-dimensionally.
Yes.
They don't live vertically.
Right.
And so the verticality of us, of this city, creates the acoustical canyon.
The depth level. Yeah.
Yeah. But also helps people kind of live on all certain levels of their consciousness.
The multi-levelness, which is
more
accepted in pre-literate cultures and post-literate cultures. Not in the literate culture. They standardized meanings from signs to dictionaries for 300 years.
Well, what would be a post-literate culture? How are we evolving towards that?
Well, we've been a post-literate culture on the deepest level since the telegraph for 150 years. But in terms of people recognizing and giving into it, it didn't happen until the satellite happened in 1950s and 60s.
Mm-hmm.
The satellite environment got us out of the electric matrix. Then we could see the electric matrix and see that it was post-literate.
So what is digital? What's the effects of digital technology?
Digital is technology replaying the history of human inventions from speech to satellite, replaying it for itself, and then presenting a human flexible face to you. That's digital. It's the machine coming alive in simple terms.
Okay, but when we get to nano, where the technology depends on molecular structures, doesn't that create a whole, and then biological machines?
Ah, see, now there you have biological machines, the fusion of first and second nature. Now, genetic engineering is going to bring in the fusion of first and second nature from its context. It will be able to invade and alter your human first nature form. And that is a software program being changed, still within software. But it's called fusion that breaks us out of whatever manipulation within the software program that technology will naturally progress towards, like nanotechnology.
What if we make these machines that are somehow biological in nature and we can transfer our consciousness to those machines? then we can live as superhuman beings.
That will happen. That will happen.
That is happening.
But it never gets, unless you get back to the eternal energy of first nature, caused and developed by cold fusion, we will never get out of that matrix that these evolved software programs are going to do. The android being, yes, will imitate the merging of first and second nature, but it'll never be immortal. It will always, it could, as it starts to nano-wise change your organs and replace them, you can consider that individually. So here is the bias. It is giving you immortality, not the collectivity. And the collectivity is broken through by cold fusion. Because the collectivity is controlled by rent.
Collectivity.
That's visual space, money, and rent. What is the common thing? Death and taxes, right? Taxes. That's the economic structure which has run humanity for thousands of years. That economic structure was necessary in that phase of evolution. But the real challenge is now is that we don't need that when you don't have to rent for food and space and oxygen when it is available. It's like the Amazonian primitive tribes who live in that utopia of the jungle.